Say yes to new beginnings.
Yes.
Say yes to new standards of excellence.
Yes.
Say yes to engaging reportage with a difference.
Yes.
Introducing Yes International Magazine. The time to say yes to your dreams and aspirations is here.
What got you interested in business in the first instance?
I've always, I remember when I was in school, even though I was a very, I didn't say I was a very bright student. I left the university at the age of 21 with a degree in production engineering. I made a very solid 2-1 in school. But, you know, I've always liked the art of transactions. I've always liked making things happen. I remember when I was in school then, I used to joke with my friends that when I leave school, I'm going to sell cement. And it was a joke. I mean, an engineering student said you're going to sell cement. It was funny. But I always liked, you know, making things happen. So the moment I left school, even though I got a job and I started working, by the time I was 28, I was already planning my exit. By the time I was 28, I had already started coming. By the time I was 30, going 31, I had left my job to go do my thing.
Alright. What is the commonest mistake that most business people make?
It's the commonest mistake people make, again, revolves around money, how you deal with money. You are only in business when your income exceeds your expenditure. And in business, if you're in paid employment, for example, your salary is fixed and firm and it's the same every month. In business, it's not like that. This month, if I make 2 million naira, the next month, you make 5 million, the next month, you make 10 million, the following month, you may lose 3 million. But you need to remain focused. You need to persevere. Even when nothing, there's this saying, hustle while you wait. Even when nothing is happening, you must be able to remain in the business and remain focused. So one big mistake a lot of businessmen make is their attitude towards money. Because it is the capital that sustains the business. Once you lose the capital, you've lost the business.
Now, what do you like most about being a businessman?
The fact that I'm my own man. My destiny is in my own hands, and of course in the hand of God. But I mean, I'm my own man. I decide to what I want to do, when I want to do it, and how I do it.
Alright. What don't you like about being a businessman?
Can be very stressful. It can be very stressful. I mean, it's a lot of responsibility. You have a lot of people working for you. You have to take responsibility for them. You have to pay their salary at the end of every month. I tell my workers that a business gets to a point where, like in Renault, for example, the Renault group, we have a staff strength of like 600 people. When you have 600 people, you have to cater for, don't have a right to wreck the business, because 600 people with their families depend on this company for their means of livelihood. Even though I'm the chief executive, I don't have a right to wreck the business, so I must conform. So it's a lot of responsibility.
All right. What distinguishes you as a businessman? What stands you out? What sets you apart from the other businessmen?
I wouldn't know, but I know that I'm very hardworking. I mean, for me, work starts at 8. It's always been like that. When I get here at 9 a.m., I feel as if I've gone late to work. If I step into this premises at 9 a.m., I'll tell my integral, you're late. Most times you come here at 8 p.m., I'm still here. I travel a lot. It's a lot of stress, but you need to keep working it. So hard work for me is very key.
All right. Now, what got you interested in the aero business? I mean, you could have gone into cement, which was like your first love in boat. You could have gone into maybe automobile or things like that. What did you settle for oil and gas?
Simple. I worked for, when I left university, I worked briefly in Kano, joined PricewaterhouseCoopers in Lagos, then joined an oil company. I worked for an oil company for 5 years, and I understood the industry. I saw money being made. I understood how to make money in the oil sector. So I came into the oil sector because that was what I understood. One thing I keep saying is that the most important thing you need in any business you want to do is knowledge. Where I have the knowledge is in the oil sector. But it's by no means that it's only the oil sector that there's money. There's money. I mean, you drive around Lagos, there are cars everywhere, there are properties everywhere. How many of them do you think are into oil? I'm into oil because I understand oil. So the key thing, you're into magazine because, I mean, I listen to you. You have done Fame, you have done Encomium, you understood how the magazine business works. And then what did you do? You went ahead and set up the Yes magazine. So I always tell people, do what you know, do what you understand. Okay. You know, so I'm into oil because I understand the oil industry.
All right, what would you say has been the wisest business decision that you have taken since you started?
I can't exactly hold on to any particular one because, I mean, running a business is an aggregation of taking decisions every day, trying to ensure that you make the right decision. But the best decision I've made, maybe leaving my paid employment to go and start Rain Oil because, I mean, it's been a fantastic journey so far.
All right, since you set up shop, can you recollect a business decision that you took and later you maybe regretted doing that?
Can I? Have I done a transaction that I've lost money that has really hurt me? I can't recollect any particular one. I think that we've been, by the grace of God, we've been pretty calculating. Pretty systematic, very methodological, and we've remained focused on what we do. I try not to dabble into things I don't understand. I tell people that if you come and meet me now and say, oh, there's an LPO, you can supply Lagos State government and computers and make $100 million, I would say I won't touch it. Why wouldn't I touch it? Because I don't understand the computer business. I don't understand the computer business. The business I understand is the oil business. So that's what I stay focused. And that's all I do. So most of the decisions I take revolve around this industry. I mean, because it's an industry I understand fairly well. And because it's an industry, I mean, I've worked on now for the past 24 years. I think I've been able to minimize my poor decisions.
Alright. Most people attain success in business, but they are not able to sustain it. Where do you think they normally get it wrong?
Well, one thing in business is that like business, just as life, is very dynamic. Change will keep happening. Businesses fail because some of them don't adapt to changes as they happen. You need to be very, very innovative to be successful in business. I remember when we started, our main product was something we call LPFO, low poor fuel oil. LPFO, or otherwise called black oil, is what companies use to fire their boilers, the breweries, the textile companies. You know, I recall one day, around the year 2000, I was driving on Uber Accra and in Ikeja, and I saw that they had dug up the side of the road and there were pipes on the road, and I called somebody. I said, what are they laying pipes for? He said, it's for gas. I said, what are they going to use gas for? He said, they are piping gas to the company so that they can use gas to fire their boilers. I went to the office, I called my staff, I said, come, LPFO is now an endangered species. We need to move away from LPFO. Because the moment all these companies hook up to gas, nobody's going to buy an ILPF. So we didn't wait for the change to happen on us. We immediately started reacting to it and started moving our money from LPFO into developing retail stations. Even though the company has grown multiple folds, I have not sold one in our early years. LPFO accounted for maybe 70% of our sales. I have not sold 1 liter of LPFO in the last 7 years because we moved away from LPFO. So you see, for you to survive a business, things will keep changing. Competition will change. Market dynamics will change. Customer taste will change. Your responsibility as a businessman is to keep adapting to those changes as they happen, not to complain why the changes are happening, because the changes must happen. You see, take things as they are and try to make money in spite of the limitations. What tends to happen is a lot of businessmen sit down and keep lamenting why things are no longer how they used to be. No. The challenge is, how do you make money in the current reality? So you must be very perceptive. You must read. You must watch what is happening in the environment. And then you must ask yourself, how does this adapt or how does this affect your business? Competition must catch up with you. Whatever you do, competition will catch up with you. You run a magazine, make no mistake about it. The day people see that you are making a lot of money running your magazine, more people will set up magazines. I remember we built a petrol station. I built a petrol station and then the petrol station was doing very well. It was obvious, but if you're doing well, people will see it. You see, the moment the station started doing well, we didn't just sit down there and say, oh, you see, this is where God has buttered our bread. This is where we will. The moment you commission it and it's doing well, start looking for the next location. Because it's only a matter of time. Competition will catch up with that location where you find yourself. But before competition catches up with that location, make sure you've gone to another location. And make sure you've got. So the business must keep regenerating itself for it to survive. Right. If you don't regenerate yourself, then the end is in sight.
All right. Your company's name is Renoyo. How did you come about it?
Very interesting. I've said this many times. In 1994, when I wanted to incorporate the business, my wife and I went to meet a friend of ours who is a lawyer and a wife. And we told the lawyer, we want to start an oil company. So we started banding names around. Why don't you call it this oil? Why don't you call it that oil? And my friend, who is a lawyer and a pastor, said, Gabriel, rain stands for blessing. Why don't you call it rain oil? And I said, NFI, you know what, you're right. Instead of rain oil, we're going to merge the rain and the oil together to get one word, which is rain oil. And that was how Rain Oil Limited was incorporated in November 1994. And it's been pretty, because it was quite prophetic, because rain oil just got up and ran.
All right. Well, what's your dream for rain oil?
My dream for Rain Oil is that Rain Oil should be a dominant player in the downstream sector of the Nigerian oil and gas industry. And we are very much on course to realizing that dream.
Okay, earlier on you said something about the world. Now, just two questions about the world before I come back to the business again. How did you meet your wife? What was that question?
I met my wife in Kano. In May 1990, a few days to my 24th birthday, I went to visit a friend of mine, And we're in his room, we're playing chess, we're seated on the floor. I wasn't wearing a shirt, I was just wearing my short, making some very serious strategic move in chess. And then this lady walked in to see my friend. And in the midst of a very serious game, she was talking to the guy and distracting us. And then I looked up at the lady and saw this fair, naturally pretty girl with her hair just flying to the back. That was my first contact with her. One thing led to the other. I got to know her. A couple of months later, we started dating. A couple of years later, we were married. And we still remain.
What's her name?
Her name is Godri Ifeanyi Ogbeche.
Okay, I saw you today's bunch. She lost her mom.
Yeah, she lost her mom. She traveled this morning.
All right,
she's gone to Condon for the funeral.
Can we meet your family? Okay, would you like to tell us about them?
Yeah, God blessed me or blessed us with three children. My first son, I have two boys and a girl. My first son, Chukwudi Ebele, who is in the university. Then my daughter, Oge, who is in secondary school. And then the baby of the house, Uche just founded on primary school. He'll be going to secondary school in September.
Alright, away from work, what keeps you busy? What keeps you happy? What keeps you engaged?
Away from work, I love to play tennis. I'm passionate about tennis. You can see I'm watching the Wimbledon tennis tournament that is going on right now. I sponsor tennis tournaments. I've played tennis since I was a kid. My recreation revolves largely around tennis, although unfortunately lately I've not had enough time to play tennis as I would have loved to, because I keep getting more and more engrossed in work.
Alright, it's obvious that God has been nice to you. What more do you want from God? What is that thing that God still has not done for you?
I wake up every morning, I pray to God and I thank Him, and I always tell Him that we've come this far not because we are too hardworking, not because we are too intelligent, not because we are too smart, but it's just the grace of God. It's just the grace of God that, so for all what He has done, for how far we've come, we just remain very grateful and we remain very thankful. Is there anything He hasn't done? No. He's done what I expect Him to do, and I thank Him for what He has done. However, life is a journey. We keep walking it. Success is a journey, it's not a destination. People may say we are successful. Yes, we may be successful, but the success only asks for more hard work to maintain it and to remain a rich man. Where the work is remaining a rich man. It's not in becoming a rich man. So we're still on that journey.
Alright, I'll just take a few more questions so that excuse you. Now, what fond memories of your childhood can you recollect? Where did you grow up? What were the things that happened then that you can remember?
I had a very interesting childhood. I started my primary school in Awuchi in 1972. My father was a policeman. We were always going on transfer. I ended up attending 5 different primary schools within 5 years in 3 different states of the Federation. I went from primary school in Awuchi, in Edo State, the current Edo State, to primary school in Obolo Afor, in the current Enugu State. From there I went to Otangba, in the current Abia State. From there I came back to Enugu Ezike, in the current Enugu State, before I ended up my primary school in Onitsha, also in the current Anambra State. So my primary school was more like itinerant, kept moving from one place to the other. I grew up in the police barracks. I remember when I was a kid growing up in the barracks, all my friends were barrack boys and we were very close. And then in Onitsha, I would see a friend who was just living on a street in Onitsha. And I used to wonder, how can you just be living on a street? How do you make friends when you just live on a street inside town on your own? I mean, I couldn't comprehend it, you know, because growing up in the barrack was fun. I mean, it was fun. And I had a very eventful childhood from there to secondary school, university, and then moved on with life.
All right. Who are your business mentors and why?
My original business mentor, a man called Engineer George Enemo. George Enemo was the managing director of Ascon Oil. He was my boss. George Enemo died in the unfortunate Bellevue plane crash of October 2005. It was an avoidable waste. A very hardworking man, very focused, very determined. George Enemo taught me that with determination, you can achieve anything. He's also a man who built an empire from the scratch. He's a man I still admire. He's a man, he actually brought me into this industry. If not for George Enemo, maybe I would not have been in the oil industry. He brought me into this industry. I worked with him for 5 years. I learned the ropes from George Enemo, and may his soul forever rest in perfect peace.
Mm-hmm. All right, most people want to attempt business, you know, but they usually entertain and not this fear, you know, this fear factor, that's this fear that is usually hindering them from taking that plunge. How did you overcome yours?
It's very easy. I didn't look too far. I broke it down into small achievable targets. And the starting place for me was, how much was I earning? I was earning X amount of money. What else can I do to make that money? Because if I could make that money, at least it can take the place of my job. So I set out just to do something that can give me the amount of money I was earning. And then from there, grew the business. You see, don't look too far. If you want to, it's like you want to build a house. If you want to build a house, you get the land, you do the foundation, you take up the block, you do the decking. Are you with me? Don't, if you want to build a house and you're waiting until you have all the money before you start, you're not going to go far. Just break it down into small targets. Okay, can I get some money to do the foundation? When you finish foundation, can I get some money to... But having said that, the Bible will admonish us that you don't put your hand on the plow and look back.
Right.
Once you put your hand on the plow, look forward.
Are you a pastor or you're just a woman who loves God?
I'm a Christian. I love God. I acknowledge God. I put God first in everything. In everything I do, I put God first. I strive my best to do the best I can for God. And I keep telling my wife that someday I'm going to be a pastor.
Okay.
I hope that comes to pass.
All right, I'll take two more questions. What's your personal definition of success? When can a man be said to have really succeeded?
A man succeeds when he begins to add a lot of value to the society. A time comes when your life, your personal life becomes too small to be the essence of your being, of your existence. Because you see, as God blesses you, at some point you find out that what you have your need is actually less than 1% of what you have. So at that point, it becomes a matter of how much value are you adding to the society, how much value are you adding to the community. You see, we need to learn from other people. I look at a man like Bill Gates. Today, he's spending all his time running the Bill Gates Foundation. He comes to Kano. For an American, Kano is middle of nowhere. He comes all the way from America and goes to Kano, donating money to take care of polio, to take care of malaria. I mean, you for me, that is success. Success is not about, oh, I'm the richest man in Nigeria. Oh, I'm the richest man in my community. Yes, for all that wealth that you have, if all that wealth is there just to meet your need and that of your family, for people to say that you're the richest man, then you've not achieved success.
All right, let me take the last question. So, now, as an employee, when is the best time for you to take the plunge? When is the best time for you to move from becoming an employee to an employer? You know, having passed through that route.
The best time to do that is when you don't have much to lose.
Okay.
When you're still young.
Okay.
When you're still young. The more you delay it and the higher you go up the career path, the more difficult it becomes. I left my job when I was just 30. I was less than 31 when I walked away from my job. I was young. I didn't have much care in the world. If I had failed, it would have been easier for me to pick the pieces and move on. Just before you came, a friend of mine came. He's an executive director in one of the banks. We are peers. We are age mates. And then he looks at me and says, oh, you're lucky when you left. It's difficult for us to do it now. They wish they can do what you did. But they are too far gone up there that they can't start, because to start a business, you really have to start from the scratch. Why a lot of businesses fail, businesses that big men start, is that they start the business with a lot of overhead. You're just starting your business, yet you want to go abroad, you still want to fly business class or first class, you still want to park 4 cars outside. I mean, all that is overhead on the business, and it's difficult to do that when you're just starting a business from the scratch. So the best time to start a business, if you really want to start a business, is when you're still well under 40.
Okay, as an employer of labor, what is the best way to cope with a staff who is good but not disciplined? Have you ever experienced such in your organization, and how do you?
A staff is good, but it's not disciplined. It's about assigning weights to what you call good, and how bad is his indiscipline on the business, and how good is that he's good. Is he good enough that he's bringing in so much money into the business? Is he so indisciplined that his indiscipline is an impediment to other people doing what they need to do? But I will tell you one thing, my mentor and my boss, George Enemoy, used to tell me, say, Gabriel, a company is like a boat. We're all on a boat. We are paddling on the boat so that the boat can keep afloat. Then while we are paddling, one man is busy fetching water into the boat, trying to capsize the boat. Gabriel, which one is better? Do we pick that man and throw him overboard so that he alone drowns, or do we allow him to capsize the whole boat and so that everybody will drown? Which one is better? We all agree it's better to pick that man and throw him overboard. So the question is, if a man is good and is very indisciplined, and his indiscipline is threatening to capsize that boat, you know what I would do?
I'll throw him overboard. I'll fire him.
All right. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.